Okay, it's now 10 o'clock, so we'll go ahead and get our webinar on COVID-19 and long-term care scams, term care scams started today. We're really excited to have with us here in our CIL webinar, Emily Wu and Nick Coates from the Federal Trade Commission to present to us about scams and ways that we can be aware of false messaging around COVID-19 and long-term care fraudulent activities. Just a little bit about the FTC. The Federal Trade Commission is a bipartisan federal agency with a unique dual mission to protect consumers and promote competition. The FTC pursues vigorous and effective law enforcement, advances consumers' interests by sharing its expertise with federal and state legislatures, and U.S. and international government agencies. It develops policy and research tools through hearings, workshops, and conferences, and creates practical and plain language educational programs for consumers and business in a global marketplace with constantly changing technologies. We're really honored to have with us Emily Wu, who is an attorney in the Los Angeles office of the Federal Trade Commission, where she conducts investigations and litigates cases on unfair, deceptive, and fraudulent business practices. She is currently on assignment to the Division of Consumer and Business Education, where she works to educate the public about scams and what to do in response. In this role, she also collaborates with community groups and other government agencies to disseminate consumer information to different communities. Before joining the FTC, Emily was an immigration attorney and worked on legal access for immigrants in removal proceedings. We're also honored to have with us Nick Coates, who is an attorney in the Western Region San Francisco office of the Federal Trade Commission. He works on both antitrust and consumer protection matters. His business practice, his work focuses on privacy matters, investigating fraud, and litigating against unfair business practices. Prior to joining the FTC, Nick was senior counsel at the Department of Transportation Office of Inspector, an assistant attorney general for the District of Columbia, and a presidential management fellow. We're going to be having a presentation from both of these two guests today. At the end, we should have a little bit of time for question and answers. For accessibility, we do have two wonderful ASL interpreters that we'll be switching off throughout the presentation. And on the bottom of your Zoom window, you should also see an option to bring up captions and a live transcript. You will also see a Q&A button down at the bottom where you can submit questions that you have. The questions can be submitted throughout the entirety of the presentation, but we will not necessarily have an opportunity to address them until the end. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Nick, who will be starting off our presentation today.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Camden. Really appreciate it. I'll give a moment here to get our presentation up. And as we're doing that, I'll just again do a quick intro. My name is Nick Coates. I'm an attorney with the Federal Trade Commission in the our San Francisco office. And with me today is Emily Wu. I can't really start this presentation without at least acknowledging some two other folks from the FTC who really helped out with this presentation. Carol Cando-Pineda, who's doing some incredible outreach in our communities, and Carly Johnson, who's really helped with this presentation. Also, we're just more generally excited to be working with the Center for Independent Living. We really see some great opportunities there to work together. We're trying to reach out to our communities, and being in the Bay Area, I'm particularly interested in working with the Center for Independent Living and seeing how we can help each other out. So today's presentation focuses on COVID and long-term care scams. But if there's one thing we really want to push for today, there is that there are a ton of scams out there. And this slide in particular is the slide that I really hope people take a moment to really understand and understand what we do, who we are, who the Federal Trade Commission is, and how we do what we do. So I'll give you a moment to take a look at the slide. So Camden gave a great introduction about what the Federal Trade Commission does. And as a general matter, we're the nation's consumer protection agency. The commission is headed by five commissioners who are presidentially appointed and confirmed by the Senate, and they each serve a 7-year term. So as far as what we do, we work to stop unfair, deceptive, and fraudulent practices in the marketplace. And we really have two areas that we look at. The first is consumer protection issues. And what we do is we take action to protect consumers from unfair and deceptive practices in the marketplace. But we also work on antitrust issues or competition matters. And what we try to do is we try to ensure and promote we have a marketplace that's free from anti-competitive mergers and business practices and policy outcomes. So how do we do that? The way we do that is really through the three methods that you see on the slide here. The first is law enforcement. We are a law enforcement agency, so we do conduct investigations and we do bring lawsuits. We do sue individuals and companies who have broken the law. We actively sue people in federal court or administrative court, and we try to get money back to people who have been involved or fallen into fraud schemes. The other thing we do is, I'm actually going to go to the third part of that bullet, the partnership portion. We partner with federal, state, and local governments to make sure that we're all working together, we're all on the same page, and we're all using the tools that we have to try to stop fraud from actually happening. And we also partner with local organizations like the Center for Independent Living to see what we can do to help each other and try to prevent fraud from happening. And part of that partnership, through that partnerships, what we hope to do is actually provide education, which is that third portion of how we do our work. And that's exactly what we're doing here today. What we hope to do is really empower everyone with information so that they know or they can identify when something could potentially be fraudulent. And stop fraudulent practices from happening or being, stop the potential to be involved in some sort of fraudulent scheme before it actually happens. So that's what we're really hoping to do today is give you some guidance, some advice on things to look for, things that we see in our, that the Federal Trade Commission sees or that have been reported to us, and give you that information so that you can identify it ahead of time and prevent the fraud from happening before there is an opportunity for it to happen. If we go to our next slide here. So this slide says top COVID-related reports, and it's got a bar graph with the top five reported COVID-related schemes that have been reported to the Federal Trade Commission. And I'll give you a moment to take a look at that slide. What you'll notice is there's really that first one is the one we'll be focusing on, online shopping scams. It's a disproportionate amount of the COVID fraud schemes that have been reported to us involve online shopping scams. And we're going to be talking about that a little more in detail. You know, one thing, if you look at the stats related to what has been reported to us, I find the stats incredibly fascinating. And if you're interested in seeing more stats in detail about what kind of scams have been reported and drilling down even further into the state level, I really encourage you to go to ftc.gov/exploredata. We have some incredible tools there that give you some real insight about what's happening nationwide and also what's happening in your local communities. And I'm just going to throw some of these stats out there because I find them absolutely fascinating. Since January of 2020 until about October of 2021, the FTC has received more than 625,000 COVID-related reports. The total fraud loss in those reports is about $582 million, so almost over $500 million. And what I find interesting is that the median fraud amount is $392. That's an incredibly high amount for a median fraud amount per individual. Again, all that information, if you want some more details or more stats, can be found on ftc.gov/explore data. And breaking down it into something that involves our actual communities, if we look at California, there are about a little over 55,000 COVID-related reports since January of 2020, totaling about $82.4 million in fraud loss. So what this really shows us is, and this is going to be sort of a common theme throughout this presentation, is that fraudsters follow the news. They come up with new fraud schemes by looking at the news and seeing what is relevant and what they can basically come up with new ideas that are targeting issues that are in the news right now. And what's in the news right now? COVID-related issues. So fraudsters are looking at issues that they can use to maybe target individuals that are concerned about COVID-related issues deal with products that are related to COVID itself. And so with that in mind, I'm going to talk a little about COVID scams that we've seen come up and COVID scams that we anticipate coming up. And more generally, we're talking about, and we're going to get into this slide in a little more detail. I'll give you a moment to look at it. We're going to be talking about COVID treatments and cures. We're also going to be talking about economic impact payments and online sales for hard to find PPE and other products that have really become part of our lives as a part of the pandemic. I also, before we get into those though, I want to take a moment to talk about frauds that we anticipate seeing in the future. And I'm going to focus really on two frauds that we anticipate coming up in the future. One being scams related to vaccines, vaccine verification scams and vaccine lottery scams. We do think that that is, fraudsters again know that this is big in the news right now, and they are going to be developing fraud schemes related to vaccine verification. So it's something to keep an eye out for, and we're gonna discuss those a little also as well. The other thing I wanted to sort of raise is another possible future scam or job-related scams. Some government assistance programs are starting to end, there is a need for people to look for, or people are looking for jobs, and there are a lot of scam artists out there who are promoting certain money-making opportunity scams. You know, it's the scams of, here, if you pay me X amount of money, I can show you how to make $250,000 a year. So we anticipate a lot of those scams coming out in the near future, or currently really. So it's something to keep an eye out for. But looking to this slide in particular, so there are a just never ending amount of people who, again, are keeping scam artists who are keeping an eye on the news, and they've identified that, hey, we can make some money off of possibly trying to sell COVID treatments and cures. So let's talk about some fake COVID treatment and cures. One thing that the FTC has done is actually send out a bunch of warning letters. We've actually sent out more than 440 warning letters to companies who are making false claims about cures, treatments, or prevention claims related to coronavirus. All those warning letters are available on our website if you want to see some of the actions that we've taken along those lines. The Federal Trade Commission has also sued companies and individuals who have made some of these claims. And the big, the heart of those the warning letters and what we're trying to put out there is you can't be making claims without providing reliable scientific proof to back up those claims. So the big takeaway is what's on this slide here. Ignore ads for products that claim to treat, prevent, or cure coronavirus. At this time also, COVID vaccines are free. You can't buy them online. I had mentioned that one of the things that we anticipate seeing is vaccine-related scams. If you see an ad or receive a call from someone who says, hey, I can sell you the vaccine, or I can get you get the vaccines quicker than everyone else, those are scams. They are scams. There's no if and or buts about it. Look to your state and local governments about who can receive vaccines and where to receive vaccines from. If you're asked to pay out of pocket for a COVID vaccine, it's likely a scam. So keep an eye out for that and understand that, again, contact your local and state governments to let them to find out where you can get vaccines and who you can get them from. There's also, we've also seen some scams related to people calling folks who are on Medicare or Medicaid and saying that, hey, we can give you special access to vaccines or certain treatments. But that's not how Medicaid or Medicaid work. They're never gonna call you to give you special access or put you in line above others to be tested or to receive certain treatments. In all likelihood, those are scammers. So again, best advice is if you get that call, hang up the phone and call up a Medicare or Medicaid representative and ask them whether that whether the information received is actually correct. Again, if you want to learn sort of the most up-to-date information about coronavirus scams, go to our webpage, fdc.gov/coronavirus. And if we go to the next slide, Emily. Thank you. So let's talk about online shopping, which is what this slide is covering. So as that graph said, I showed earlier, shows online shopping scams, COVID-related scams, were the number one reported scams to the Federal Trade Commission. They've really, really surged during the pandemic. From April through May of 2020, over half of online shopping complaints related to items that were ordered but never delivered. And the most common item reported but not delivered were face masks. But then we also have items like sanitizer, toilet paper, thermometers, and gloves not being delivered. So again, a perfect example of how fraudsters are keeping an eye on the news, seeing that there's a shortage of a certain product, for example, PPE, toilet paper, or sanitizer, and they're putting up web pages, fake web pages saying, hey, we have these products, come buy it from us. And then they just, you pay and you never receive anything back. What some of these companies will actually do, which is, again, very tricky. These are sophisticated scam artists. They'll use logos, or they'll steal logos really from well-known products, or use URLs that are just a little off. So for example, you might have something that says Clorox or Lysol, but maybe Lysol will have two L's instead of one L in the URL. And you think you're buying a legitimate product, but in fact, you're going to a scam artist's website who's not going to actually provide that product. So what can we do to possibly prevent that from happening, or at least stop it, identify possible fraud schemes? For one thing, if an in-demand product is out of stock and you can't find it anywhere, but you find a website that not only says that they have a giant amount of that product, but they're selling it at a higher price, you may want to take a breath, and do a little more research before you commit to it, because there is a possibility that could, in fact, be a fraud site. you also always want to look at refund policies and whether there are any restocking fees if you do purchase some of these products. Some of these products are actually coming from overseas also. If that's happening, make sure that you look to see whether there are additional import or custom tax fees that could be hidden that you're not aware of, that these companies may tag on later on. As a general matter also, US companies need to be able to tell you about shipping delays, possible shipping delays, and offer you a right to cancel and get a full refund. Companies will sometimes say stuff like, we'll get you this product by next week. If they make those type of statements, they need to be able to show that they actually can get that product out to you by next week. There's always things that different factors that might affect their how much time it actually takes to get there. But at least when they're advertising and they're selling this product, they need to be able to tell you correct information about when you can actually expect to receive that product. One other tip, and this is sort of, since a lot of these scams are online scams, this is pretty much the only way, but pay with credit card, pay with credit cards. Credit card companies give you a bit of protection by allowing you to file a chargeback dispute. So if you do think that a fraudulent company has taken your money and isn't providing your product, you can contact the credit card company and they can help you either get that money back or stop payment before it's actually received by the scam artist. And Emily, I'll turn it over to you.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much. And we've also switched our interpreters to Sheila, so you can also hopefully follow along. Based on the COVID-related reports the FTC has gotten since January 2020, it looks like scammers are using a variety of methods to reach people. So on this slide, we have a bar chart showing that the most reported method of reaching people was by email. The category of websites or apps comes in second, followed closely by text. Our other categories are other, phone calls, social media, mail, an online ad or pop-ups, and that rounds out the rest of the reported contact methods. For text messages specifically, people reported receiving scam text messages related to bogus offers to earn income, like Nick had mentioned, phony economic relief programs, fake charities, and government imposters. We have here on the slide as well an example of a scam email. So here it looks like an email that's coming from the World Health Organization. It says, "Dear sir, go through the attached document on safety measures regarding the spreading of coronavirus." Coronavirus is two words here. And then it says, "Click on the button below to download." And then in a blue button, it says safety measures. Symptoms, common symptoms include fever, and then in one word, cough, see, shortness, of breath, and breathing difficulties. Regards, Dr. Stella Chen Gong, specialist Wuhan-virus-advisory. And then we added in red on the right bottom side of the email, fake, because we want you to know this is a fake email example. So oftentimes people would receive something like this, something that might have some typos in it, something that might have a link to download and may not address you personally. Here's what we tell people about emails you might get during the pandemic. On this slide, we have a graphic of a laptop. It says, "Don't click on links in emails from sources you don't know." Scammers are sending hashtag coronavirus emails that will download harmful software onto your computer. And then we have a link that says ftc.gov/coronavirus/scams so that you can learn more. And that should be the same link that Nick had said earlier. So scammers send emails and texts that look real, hoping to trick you into clicking on the link or sharing your information. And if you click on that link, they could wind up putting malware on your computer or your phone. So even if it looks like the message might be from somebody official, like your bank or FedEx or another company you're familiar with, don't click on links if you're not expecting an email or text message. Sometimes you could even get an email from someone you personally know, but if their email was hacked, any links or attachments in those emails could also contain malware. So remember, don't click on links in unexpected emails or texts, whether you think you know the source or not. Scammers are sending coronavirus-related emails that will download harmful software onto your computer. And please visit that link, ftc.gov/coronavirus/scams, if you're interested in finding out more. We will also have a handout with all of these links that we're referencing so later on. So if you don't have to jot down these links right now, you will get them in a handout as well. So I'm gonna give everyone a second to digest the slide a little bit. So Nick mentioned that there are what we call impersonator scams. That's when scammers are pretending to be someone you might trust. These are also known as imposter scams. And they're the most commonly reported type of fraud now, at least since 2017. Imposter scammers or impersonator scammers may claim to be a well-known company or a beloved family member, but FTC data suggests that pretending to be the government may be their favorite method. And whatever they pitch, they all have one thing in common. They want your money, and they want your personal information. In 2020, scammers adapted these scams to what was happening in the headlines, like Nick mentioned earlier, coronavirus. So the fake email pretending to be from the WHO is one example of how scammers can impersonate a government agency. Scammers might call to offer things like a COVID-19 kit, coronavirus package, or even Medicare benefits related to the virus. And they'll ask you to verify personal information like your bank account, your social security number, or your Medicare numbers. If you get a call from someone who says they're a Medicare rep and they ask for this information, hang up. It's a scam, it's not Medicare calling. And you can report it to the FTC at reportfraud.ftc.gov. We also heard that there were a lot of these types of scams around economic impact payments. And the FTC also got a lot of reports about fraudulent calls, texts, and emails coming from people pretending to be from the Social Security Administration, the IRS, the Census, and the FDIC. So these fake government messages might say that you're approved for money, you can get quick relief payments or get cash grants due to the coronavirus. They might also promise that you small business loans or send a phishing alert that a check is ready to be picked up. These are all scams. None of these messages come from a government agency. If the government comes out with any more financial relief for people because of COVID, we expect that scammers will come out with more related scams. And they could use the same method when it comes to scams related to the child tax credit or any other government grant scams. We mentioned earlier that now that COVID vaccines are out, you may get a message through email, text, or social media that looks like it's from your state saying that you won that vaccine lottery. The message might have a link in it asking you for personal information. In California, winners will be notified by an official with the California Department of Public Health. Winners will not be asked to pay any fees associated with the prize, and they will not be asked for their bank information. So if governments and businesses, and they are now starting to require proof of vaccination for many businesses to enter, you can probably anticipate that scammers will try to start or will find a way to take advantage of this new requirement. But I'm not sure what that might look like, but just be aware that could happen. And as we said earlier, someone could call you pretending to be one of your family members saying that they're in trouble and they need you to send money right away. And they might even have a valid sounding explanation or a reason for why they sound kind of different on the phone. Tech support scammers want you to believe that you have a serious problem with your computer, like a virus, and they want you to pay for tech support services that you don't need to fix a problem that doesn't exist. We've also heard that since 2016, romance scams have been increasing steadily. It's possible that because of the pandemic, more people are using these types of apps, but it's been on the increase for several years now. And these scammers create these attractive online profiles, and sometimes they make up a person or even assume the identity of a real person. They make up plausible reasons to not meet you in person, especially during the pandemic. And even if you're not on these apps, a scammer could reach out to you through social media like Facebook or Instagram, through a friend request or a direct message. And we have a link here, ftc.gov/imposters, that talks about these types of scams. Again, this link will be on the handout. So the common link between all these types of scams is that people want your money or your personal information. So this next slide is about payment methods. In all of these situations, what we ask that you do is to just slow down and talk with someone you trust if you're asked to send someone money or to give up your personal information. So one way to spot a scam is to pay attention to the way the scammer wants you to pay. They often ask you to pay by wiring money, putting money on a gift card, a prepaid card, or a cash reload card. And they may even ask you to use a money transfer app because they know that these types of payments can be hard to reverse. So just know that no legitimate business will ever ask you to pay in one of these ways. Anyone who insists that you pay them by wire transfer, gift card, prepaid card, or money transfer app is a scammer. Sometimes scammers even start the scam by sending you a check first. It seems real because they always have some kind of explanation. They may tell you to deposit the check and then send some of the money back to them or onto someone else. But while the bank legally has to make the money from that deposited check available to you in your account, it actually takes the bank a bit more time to determine that the deposited check was fake. So if it's a fake and you already sent on some money to someone from that deposit, the bank is going to want you to repay them that money. So imposter scams can hit very close to home. For example, a scammer recently posed as the sales Stuart James, previously at the cell, and sent instructions to a new staff member to buy gift cards and then share pictures of the gift card numbers and the PINs. So I'm gonna read this scam email. Okay, sorry, I didn't email you back yesterday. Please get this done this morning. I need your help with a purchase. I'm looking to surprise some of the staff with Google Play gift cards, but I want you to keep it on the low pending till when they get it. You will be reimbursed back immediately when the surprise is out. So therefore, I need you to purchase 5 pieces of Google Play gift cards in $200 face value amounting to $1,000. It's all right if you can purchase the gift cards from any stores around like CVS, Target, Best Buy, or Walgreens. I need you to help get the physical gift cards. Scratch the back out to reveal the PIN, then attach the pictures showing the PIN to this message and email them back to me. Is that clear? How soon can this be done now? Thanks, Stuart James. So this kind of scam is very common. An employee gets a message that seems to come from a company higher up, directing them to wire the money, transfer funds, or send gift card codes. In reality, a scammer might have faked the boss's email address or phone number, or the scammer may use a different email or phone number, but signed up with the boss's name. We talked earlier about how this might happen also in an IT scam. So in this type of scam, the call or message seems to come from a member of your tech staff asking for a password or telling you to download software. So with people working from home, there may be additional hurdles to making sure that all this technology works, and maybe your tech support team is swamped. So if scammers do a quick online search, they might get a little more information to really sell their story. They might say something or if they find out someone on your team is named Fred, they might say, "I spoke with Fred, who said you were having a computer problem." And by using this little bit of information, they could make you believe that they're actually part of your team. So what happened in these email scams and in many imposter scams is often called phishing, because scammers are phishing for your money or your information. These emails appear to be from someone you know or a well-known source like an internet service provider, a bank, or a mortgage company. So here's what you can do. Read the email carefully and look for inconsistencies. You can verify instructions by speaking with the person directly. Don't click on any links or download software in any suspicious emails, texts, or direct messages. Update your security software and use multi-factor authentication. And back up your data. And as always, don't give out your passwords, your personal information, or your financial information to someone who contacts you. I'm turning it back over to Nick now.
Thanks, Emily. I just want to quickly point out, we're receiving a lot of great questions in the chat and the Q&As, and keep them coming. If you guys have any questions along the way, please put them in there. We're not ignoring you. We're just going to answer all the questions all at once at the end. But I already see some great questions in there. So definitely don't be shy. Feel free to ask as many questions, and we'll open it up later also if folks want to ask questions at the end as opposed to typing it in. So now we're going to move away from some of the COVID scams that we were talking about, although some of these will also involve COVID-related issues, and talk about some more long-term care scams. And the one that immediately comes to mind are Social Security Disability Insurance scams, or SSDI scams. These have been around forever. And the reason they've been around forever is because they're incredibly effective. So how does this normally work? Someone will reach out to someone who's either applying or maybe eligible for SSDI benefits and say that, hey, I can help you with your application. Or if you're already involved in the process, they might say, something's wrong with your SSDI benefits. I can help you out, but I need some information. What they're trying to do is get information from you, your personal information. And the reason they want that information is either to steal your identity or be able to access your benefits and take your benefits. So realizing that these scam artists are out there, what are some things that we all can do to protect ourselves and people who you know who might be receiving SSDI benefits? First off, the big thing to know is don't give out your social security number or your really any sort of personal identifiers, account numbers, that kind of type of information. And this, we're just going right down the slide here, all the different bullet points that were that are on this slide. Another thing to keep in mind, don't wire money or send money using a prepaid debit card. That's not how those benefits work. The government doesn't accept payment through those means. So that should be a real red flag. If someone says, hey, I need you to pay through some sort of prepaid debit card or wire us some money, that should be a red flag to say, hey, let's stop. Let's figure out whether this is legitimate or not. And the best advice I can give you is hang up the phone and call someone from the Social Security Administration directly and ask them, hey, I received this call. Is this actually something that that you guys need in order for me to get my benefits? Here's a general principle that all scam artists use. They're gonna pressure you. They're gonna push on all your different pressure points. They're gonna try to create fear. They're gonna try to intimidate. They're gonna say your benefits are gonna disappear. You're not gonna have access to this money. Or in the worst case scenario, and some of you may have received these, I know I've received these, you get phone calls with someone saying, you've done something wrong and the FBI is gonna come arrest you. All those pressure tactics and the need to do stuff immediately are classic signs of a fraud scheme. So if they're saying you need to do this right now, take a moment, stop, and say, I need a moment to think about this. You can be polite and say, I'll get back to you guys. But to be honest, in all likelihood, it is a fraud scheme, and I would encourage you to just hang up. There's nothing wrong with hanging up the phone and contacting the Social Security Administration and letting them know or asking them whether they actually need the information that you were asked about. If you do think that a scammer has gotten your personal or financial information, one thing to, or a great website to go to is identitytheft.gov. It's a great guide for, a real step-by-step guide for what to do if you think your information has been stolen. It tells you really, again, a great step-by-step guide of who to contact, what to look for, and what to do. Also, if you do think in particular your SSDI benefits were in any way affected, immediately contact the Social Security Administration's Office of Inspector General. And that's on this slide here. Their website is oig.ssa.gov/report. And lastly, a common theme, I think you're gonna be getting this, hearing this a lot, make sure you let us know, let the Federal Trade Commission know. You can go to reportfraud.ftc.gov. And the reason we want this information, the reason we really encourage you to provide us this information is so that we can hear about the frauds that are going on and maybe try to take some enforcement action. But also, if you recall, one of the prongs that I mentioned is we try to educate people about the frauds that we're currently seeing. So if we see that there's been an uptick in SSDI scams, that can be one tool that we can use is to go out and tell the public, hey, there's this spike, keep an eye out for these SSDI scams. So we really encourage you and we really hope that if you do see this type of scam or any scam really, or if you know someone who has been involved in one of these scams, to let them know to contact us so that we can provide that outreach and we can educate the public in our communities so that we can prevent that fraud from happening. If we can go to the next slide, Emily, thank you. So this slide is continuing on with long-term care issues, and I'll give you a moment to look it over. So again, a big takeaway is fraudsters follow the news. And what's been in the news? Economic impact payments or stimulus checks. A lot of people, there's always a lot of talk about these checks coming out, what's happening, who can receive them. A lot of fraudsters have latched onto that information and tried to find fraud schemes to be able to get that information or to get your personal information to possibly steal your identity. When the first economic impact payments came out in 2020, the FTC actually issued an alert. And again, this is based off of information we were receiving. One more reason to report these type of frauds. But we, as a result of the information we received, we issued an alert about care facilities requiring residents on Medicaid to sign over their stimulus checks to the facilities. But those stimulus checks were actually tax credits, and nursing homes and assisted living facilities can't take that money from the residents. So if this happened to you, or if you know someone who had that happen or that incident happened to them, the best thing to do is to immediately contact your state attorney general's office here in California. That's oag.ca.gov. And they have tools to be able to hopefully get some of that money back. And also, again, always report it to the FTC. Again, I know we're giving out a lot of URLs, and thank you so much for the people from the Center for Independent Living who are putting it into the chat box. But as Emily said, if you didn't quite get a chance to jot things down, we're going to be sending out a helpful flyer with all the contact information that we're discussing today. Actually, if we could go back to the previous slide real quick, Emily, I'm sorry. I want to talk quickly about long-term care insurance also, moving away from stimulus checks and talking about long-term care insurance. So long-term care insurance or insurance matters more generally aren't something that the FTC really typically works on. But the principles in purchasing any item where someone is either pushing you or where there could potentially be fraud is something that more generally the FTC always works on. It always applies anytime you're making any type of purchase that you're not familiar with. So before you buy long-term insurance, we just want to sort of throw some possible things to think about. And this really, again, goes to any purchases that you're really unfamiliar with. For insurance in particular, just make sure you understand what is and what isn't covered by insurance. Salespeople have a way of pitching things and hiding the negatives to get you to buy certain products. And that's no different in long-term care insurance. So they might not fully disclose what is or isn't covered, or you might have other insurance that overlaps with long-term care insurance. And really serves no purpose that salesperson is not going to tell you about. So it's really being informed, asking a lot of questions. Don't be shy about asking questions. The other tactic, we talked about this a little, is the pressure tactics. If a salesperson is pressuring you either through scare tactics or by saying, hey, time is of the essence, you need to do this immediately. None of this stuff typically requires immediate action. It's always best to be safe, take a moment, get some recommendations, maybe seek a second recommendation from someone, speak to your community or friends or family members, ask them questions to see whether what is being proposed to you is actually in your best interest. There's also a great place to look at the National Association of Insurance Commissioners. Their website is naic.org. That can be a great place to potentially look for more information about insurance. If we go to the next slide, Emily. All right. Now we're going to talk about protecting your structured settlements and factoring. Structured settlements are typically tax-free payments that are meant to meet your monthly expenses. And fraudsters, again, will look to people who have structured settlements and find ways to potentially grab that information or get your money. One legal way of doing this is actually called factoring. And what factoring is they say, we'll give you essentially a lump sum of money ahead of time in exchange for your future payments. And the lump sum that you get is less than the expenses that you receive, that you would receive over time with your individual payments. There are a lot of red flags when it comes to factoring. And I guess the bottom line really is understand what you're getting into. This should be an indicator. States actually require, most states, including California, require a judge to actually approve factoring before it actually happens, which sort of shows how much potential room there is for nefarious actions in there. If you're moving towards factoring, make sure you understand the terms. Ask for specifically what information or what amount of money you're receiving and the amount of money you would have received through your regular payments, and get everything in writing. Emily, if we move on to the next, let's move to the next slide, please. This slide is titled Alternatives to Factoring. There are other alternatives to factoring. One is really just to contact your creditor or your loan servicer and asking them for help, saying, hey, I need some sort of payment plan, is there any sort of deal we could essentially come up with to help me pay back some whatever I owe. I'm going to give you a moment to look over the slide real quick. And what I'll say is, I'll boil down this slide into one sentence. Seek advice. Don't enter into factoring without really understanding what it is that you're getting into. Speak out to, there's a lot of organizations that can provide you with good information. Seek counseling. Go out there and understand what factoring is, really understand what the terms are before you sign on the dotted line. And make sure, again, don't feel shy about asking questions. With that, I'll turn it back over to you, Emily.
All right. Hopefully my internet connection is working. I am going to actually kind of skip over the next few slides to allow time for questions. Basically, the takeaway from these slides is that we want you to go to reportfraud.ftc.gov. We have it available in Spanish as well. If you see any of these scams or have anything to report to the FTC, some other law enforcement agencies are also able to see these reports. So it's kind of a one-stop shop for many different agencies. If you prefer to call, there's also a number on this slide, 877-382-4357. And I am just going to skip over the next slides and go to the end so that we can take questions, but also we'll ask the Center for Independent Living to send these slides out so that you can peruse these on your own time. And I'll turn it back to Nick.
Thanks, Emily. I want to leave as much time as possible, but I just want to send a big thank you again to the Center for Independent Living. We're really excited to work with you guys, and we're actually really glad everyone participated here today. We hope you keep in contact. And again, If you are involved with fraud or you have questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. Please report using the emails or the websites that we've given you. Here's our contact information. Please keep in touch. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out. Again, I'm in the Bay Area, so I'm local. Definitely don't feel free to definitely reach out. That being said, I want to jump right into our questions because I know we're short on time. I see a question about price gouging. Specifically, what comments can you make regarding price gouging? How can you determine if it's legitimate increased cost due to supply issues versus actual gouging, and what methods of reporting suspected gouging? This is a great question. And it's a tough question to answer. It's hard to, without actual numbers and really having someone who's familiar with that market, it's really hard to determine whether something is just a natural increase to a supply shortage, or whether there's actually price gouging involved. I wish I had a simple answer to say, like, this is exactly what you need to look for. But what I can say more generally is, and what we touched upon on in this presentation, is with products that are particularly low in demand, if you see a website or a company that is actually selling that product, but selling it at an extraordinarily high rate, or even just an increased rate, that should be a moment to pause and say, is this actually a legitimate company? It's incredible what you can do with just general online searches. Searching for the company or the product and searching it with words like scam, complaint, review, will hopefully pull up some information that can help you make an informed decision about whether this is a legitimate company, and whether this is, hopefully it'll give you more information as to whether this is just a regular price increase that you should expect in the market, or whether it's potentially price gouging.
If it's all right, I can take the next two questions in the question box, Nick.
Sure.
These are actually pretty easy answers. The first question is, what information do we need when we report a suspected scam to the FTC? I would say as much information as you're able to share. There is a lot that we need in order to understand what happened, but as long as you leave your contact information in the report, we may be able to follow up with you. So if you're willing to have the FTC reach out, if someone comes across your complaint, and there's no guarantees we will, but if there's enough information in there for us to gauge something's going on with your complaint or with the experience you're having, then it'd be helpful to have your contact information in there and just the basic scheme of what's happening to you or what you've seen. And also I would ask that you keep related documents and emails, anything that would help in document form. And on the second question, do you provide lists of questions to ask long-term care insurance companies? On the handout, there should be a link to these types of information about these types of scams. If you follow that link, there will be an article that has this information, and you can read it on your own time. I'm sorry, since we're running out of time, I don't really have much more than a minute to explain, but we will ask that the Center for Independent Living send out the handout as well as our slides so that you can see this. The last question, I get several calls every day from scammers. Is it worth reporting each call, especially since doubt the telephone numbers are legit? That's true. Scammers do spoof numbers. And the more information we get, the more helpful it is to us generally. I would just ask, if you experience something that you feel is worth reporting, please do report it to us. And I'm not sure if I missed any other questions.
So there were a few questions that were posted on the chat. Joy, I got your question about information about or having difficulties receiving free credit reports. In the chat box, I sent a link that's on our webpage that talks about how to get those free credit reports and what you can do if you're having some issues. Again, you have my contact information, but definitely feel free to reach out. Lastly, I'll say quickly, Gary, I saw your example of a text message. I would say 100% that is a scam. If others want to take a quick look at that. Again, this is a classic example of a phishing scam, someone trying to get you to send them personal information so they could either potentially steal your identity or get access to your financials. We're running out of time, or we have run out of time. So I just want to thank everyone again so much. Thank you for the Center for Independent Living. We're really, again, excited to work with you guys. Again, you have our contact information. Please do not hesitate to reach out if you know of other organizations that might be interested or might benefit from having some sort of fraud training. Definitely reach out to us and let us know what we can do to help. With that, I'll turn it back over to Camden.
All right. Thank you, Nick. And thank you, Emily. We really want to thank both of you for being here today and for the very useful information that you've shared with the community. And we do want to encourage the community to reach out to review these resources, to reach out to Emily, Nick, and the FTC to report any suspicious activity that they're finding, because it is really important to all of us that, you know, correct information is out there and that we keep everyone safe. As a reminder, this webinar has been recorded and it will be posted on the CIL's YouTube channel at a later date. You should also see more information about that coming through our social media. And as referenced earlier, there will be a handout that is sent out to all registered attendants that provides additional information about the links that were mentioned through this webinar. That way you didn't have to write everything down. Again, we want to thank Nick and Emily and the Federal Trade Commission for putting on this webinar with us and for the wonderful information and preparation. We want to thank our ASL interpreters and for all the hard work that they've done through this webinar. And we also want to thank other staff members from the CIL and the FTC for their background support during this webinar. We hope that everybody has a great week and continues to stay safe. Thank you.